Then, just a few words about Amnesty International, because almost everybody heard about Amnesty International, but few people, they really know what we are doing. In fact, Amnesty International, their main mission is to protect and to promote human rights. And when we say that, it's really for all. It's one of our big focus is to fight against discrimination. Okay, and we have been created in 1961 by three lawyers. One of them is Peter Benenson, he's very well known, British lawyer. And at the beginning, really, it was to mobilize people around the world to free what we called prisoners of conscience. It means people that they were imprisoned because of their opinion. And this is really a concept, if I can call it this way, that was created by Amnesty. And this is really a particular case because when someone is in prison and we consider that is on because of unfair trial or because political reason, etc., what we ask is for a fair trial. But when we really consider, and is a kind of label we apply to the people, those people were in prison just for their opinion, we consider that they have to be free immediately, and we are able to mobilize hundreds of thousands of people worldwide in a few weeks to write, to call for them to be free. And since 61, we have obtained the liberation of thousands and thousands of people in this way of action. But it's not, from the beginning we have changed a lot. We won the Nobel Peace Prize, it was in 77, yes. And this was for our campaigning on the against torture, that we obtained the adoption of a convention against torture by the UN few years later. We have a special status at different international organizations. Of course, the most famous is the UN, and we have team and offices in New York, but also in Geneva, for instance, because here is where we have the Human Rights Council at the UNESCO, but also at the French International Organization, no, the Francophonie, okay. Francophonie International Organization at the EU level, but also at the American organization level and the African one. But really, Amnesty is fully recognized today. We have a presence with section, it means with entities, in 72 countries and worldwide over 7 million of supporters in more than 150 countries. In some of them, we are not allowed even to enter, and there are many countries. And in France, and this is quite important for us today, we have 80,000 members, over 200 donors, and a staff quite big. People does not imagine that Amnesty can be so big, including in terms of staff, because 90 people is quite huge if you consider that we are talking about an NGO that is working on human rights. By the way, we are the biggest human rights organization today. And we have local entity that is very important for us in terms of mobilization when we need so, and I will show you how does it work. And one maybe of the most important point for Amnesty is that we are completely independent from the financial point of view, and this is helping us to be completely independent, okay? You know what does it mean. And it means that we don't receive any money from government, from international, even if we are part of the UN, for instance, we never receive money from any of those organization. And of course, what is very important for us is to be impartial, because I will say that the most important point for us is that is our credibility, you know, and everything we do, of course, is to have impact on human rights, but we always consider the fact that we have to maintain our credibility, because once someone contacts, but not someone, because, you know, when we issue a report in Russia, okay, they said that we are not independent or impartial, and but when we issue a report on the U.S., Russia will say, "Oh, international the report on Amnesty International on the U.S. they show that there are the bad guys." It means that, but this is how they try also to use us in their own you know, policy and their own communication. But you know, when we present a report on the UN, anyway, we never have a problem in terms of credibility, in terms of impartiality, and this is very good. And I have to say that one of the reasons I have been so with the Amnesty for so many years, and I continue to be so involved, is to know that, you know, when there are bad guys, okay, we can denounce, we can mobilize against them, and we don't care which country, which political issue, we don't care. We just, there are bad guys, there are a target, that's it. And I like this, okay. voilà. Then, the way we work, we started, as I said, calling for the freedom of prisoner of conscience, but today we have three main, I will say, activities. The one is to investigate. More than 90% of Amnesty report is based on Amnesty research. And this is very important because this is our credibility. Okay. I will not go in detail. Maybe you have some question about this particular point later, but all researchers, they go to the field, even when it's very, very tough. Here you have the picture of Donatella Rovera. Donatella is our main senior research on crisis situation. She is there in Syria. She went there even if it was forbidden. It was in 2012-2013 to investigate on war crime, and you can imagine how dangerous it can be, but we go there to for our own research. But on top of that, we have a network around the world that is very, very robust. And for instance, when we start working on Syria, nobody has, at least media, etc., they don't have contact there. We have contact there because we knew already the organization. We knew because we were already working with them. But sometimes we have been, for instance, mobilized to free, you know, the grandparent, and then the father, and you can imagine that the son is working with you, with us, and on a very confident way. It means that we can have relation with some family, with some organization since 61, and you can imagine how robust can be our network based on that. Okay. Then what we do, as I say, is first to investigate, and our investigations are based on fact, not on opinion. When we say that we are impartial, this is a point. You know, we don't anticipate, we don't analyze the causes, political or any other issue behind. We are not journalists, we are not researchers, academic research, we human rights activists. It means that what we are concerned about is the fact, how the fact have impacts on the human rights, on the life of people. We don't care about why, you know, it's a humanitarian crisis, except if it's going to help to solve the crisis. But our concern is why people they don't have enough food, they don't have enough medicine, and the impact on their life. Okay. Then we lobby governments, because most of the time, you know, the government that they are committing abuses, they really, quite often it's very difficult to lobby to them. For instance, if I take the case of Syria, it's very difficult to lobby Syria. Bashar al-Assad is not listening to us. But what we do is to go to the UN, is to go to the different international organizations, not NGOs, but really like the UN and others. And also what we call third party, third country, that they can have an influence. You know, and in this case, for instance, one of the main targets, if I speak about Syria, of course, will be the member of the Security Council of the UN, because they can take a measure against the regime, or the EU, or other organizations, or other states. But this is very important. And we also go to the media to make it popular. Okay, for the people to know what is happening, because we can see that in many cases, even if you say what is happening in a country, nothing happens. And Syria is a good example of that. Then you have to go to the media and to mobilize the people. And this is really for us very important, because, you know, someone told me, and you know, what is important on what Amnesty is doing is that we disclose what states, what governments, what some people would like to hide. And just to put it on light, it's very important. Then also, we work with people who are on the field, and they are doing the job there. Very often, you know, we can hear that, okay, we have a Norse-white vision of human rights. No, we are just on the aspiration of people to really have access to the what we call economical, social, and cultural rights, but also political and civilian rights. And as we can see in many countries, and this is really worldwide today, you know, the aspiration for freedom, the aspiration not to be tortured, the aspiration for to speak freely, sorry, but all the association, etc., even for a woman to choose with whom she's going to get married, you know, those are aspirations that they are shared at the global level. It's not just about to have enough food, it's also about freedom, and freedom of opinion, freedom of association. And what we do, we work with what is defined by the international law as the human rights defender, people that are defending the human rights. And to do that also, not so only we try to protect them, we work with them, but also we have big educational programs, and this is everywhere. We have educational program in France, but also in Paraguay or in Tunisia, etc., just for the people to know their rights and then to make them able to free to fight for their own right, and it's not for us to impose the rights, it's to help them to work for their own rights. One of the big aspects, and this is something I am going to develop with the social responsibility, is how we lobby. And you know, at the international level, you know, everything started, I will say, in 1948 with the human right, the Universal Human Rights Declaration, and it's a declaration. The declaration is not binding, okay, and it has been adopted by the UN. All the states today, part of the UN, are. They have adopted the Human Rights Declaration, and even some they say today, oh, but you know, this was adopted by white people just after the Second World War for a few states. Oh, just to remember that at that time, just a few states were independent. Most of the state, the state we have today, in fact, they were colony of others, you know, and they didn't have a seat on the UN. And this is also important, you know, but today all of them, they have adopted. And as this text is non-binding, they we have two main texts. One is the on economical, social, and cultural rights. The other one is on political and civilian rights. It's very interesting because if we go back to those times, it was the Cold War or War Cold?
Cold War.
Cold War. Okay, then you have the West Bloc, okay, they adopted and they were really promoting. I don't say if they were really defending the rights, and I have to say no, they were not. But they were promoting this, the political and civil right. It means that it was everything about, you know, what we call, they call democracy, but free election, free speech, and freedom of association, etc. While the East Bloc, okay, and mainly the communists, okay, they were promoting the economical, social, and cultural right. And you can see that one of the best examples we still have today, for instance, is Cuba. Cuba is very, very strong in terms of economical, social, cultural right. We, when we speak about Cuba, we, of course, we have real strong problem with political and civil rights. There is almost no freedom of speech. There is no independent organization. It means not only NGO, but also union and media, etc. But on the other hand, we have very high level of education, very high level of health, very high level also in terms of housing, etc. And we can see how it was split during the Cold War. In 89, okay, when the, with the fall of the wall in Germany, you know, all of a sudden people realized that, you know, the Human Rights Declaration is both, okay? And some in the West country, we say, oh, new rights. No, there are new rights. The right for water, the right for education, the right to access to health services, etc. is there are no new rights. It's just that we forgot them for a while. But in the declaration, the one from 48, we have all those rights. And what we do, it's and what we did for the last 60 years is, in fact, how, you know, from the Human Rights, Universal Human Rights Declaration, we have been developing new convention, new treaty, that there are binding. Of course, when we say there are binding, you say, okay, but they continue to kill, they continue to torture. What does it mean, binding, okay? In fact, when a treaty is adopted by the UN, it has to be, we need a minimum of signature and then ratification by the local parliament, excuse me, by the local parliament. And for instance, most of the treaties between 20 and 50 ratification to be in force. When it's in force, the UN is going to create a special committee that is going to follow the implementation of the treaty in the country they have ratified. It means that they have to integrate in their own law, okay, to become also in force in the country with specific regulation. And this is a very, very long process. It can take years. But then the victims or the person, the right have been abused, they can go to the committee once they have been through all the justice system of their own country to get justice. One of the good examples for me, I am working a lot on this right now, it's, for instance, the question of the forced enforced disappearance, okay? What we call enforced disappearance, it's when the state arrest someone, but this person disappears. We don't know where is she or her. Sometimes they even don't register where the person is. The most known case, and it was the basis of the convention, is the disappearance in Argentina in the 70s, 80s. The estimation is about 30,000 people disappeared, and in 2 weeks it will be the 40th anniversary of the Madre de la Plaza de Mayo. I'm coming from Argentina, they have been working very hard to know the truth, to find the disappeared people, etc. And this convention, today we realize that even if it's enforced, it has been ratified by several countries, we continue to have disappearance. One of the cases I am following very closely is the one of the 43 students of Ayotzinapa in Mexico. And we are working closely with the committee of the first and first disappearance on the UN. And this is something really we are following, and we have the case there, etc. At the meantime, the case also, of course, is going to the, because we have other jurisdiction, like the, in Europe is the, Cour européenne des droits de l'homme, the European Court of Human Rights. Okay, we have a similar court now also in the Americas. Okay, and we have also some jurisdiction in Africa. We are trying to build some also in the Asia Pacific area, because more, you know, more possibility we have for the victim of abuse to get justice, better is. Then, you know, it's when it's adopted at the local level, we are going to follow the implementation, because, you know, it's not because something is adopted at the UN level, at the local level, that really it's going to be applied and the victim will be protected. And the case of Mexico, it's a good example. They are just now working to adopt the Mexican law on enforced disappearance. And it's very interesting because this was the convention was adopted by the UN in 2006. Mexico was really one of the most convinced promoters of the convention, but you can see that over 10 years after, still they don't have their own law, and of course they are not implementing it. To do that, we work a lot with foreign affairs minister, and also we monitor foreign affairs policies. And the target to do that, of course, is MPs, authorities, government, etc. And when we need, okay, we use activists. One of the good examples, it's the Arms Trade Treaty. This treaty took over 10 years to be adopted. And of course, before to obtain a resolution by the UN General Assembly to work on the treaty, it took us almost 10 years already. It means that, you know, we have been campaigning, we had one of the biggest campaign we never had on with this for this treaty, and we got 1 million pictures we bring to Kofi Annan. At that time he was the general secretary, and we have been lobbying very, very hard only for the UN decide to work on the possibility for a treaty. It can take a lot of time, but here we have really people opposing very hard, and not only the state, but all the people working on the arm and the military services, etc., etc. It has been very, and you, when you know how strong they are, we really are like a small, you know, glass of, of you know, comment dire, un ver de terre. C'est, you know, we are really nothing. They are so huge, so much money, etc. Well, but we do it. And you can see that, okay, we start working on the treaty in 2009. It was adopted in 2013, the 24th of December. We were very happy because we really thought that it will not be adopted. And then we have to work for the ratification by the French Parliament. And here, it has been awful, really awful, because, well, you know, at the beginning, we were working with the MOFA and the people at the working at the General Assembly in New York and in Geneva, etc., from the MOFA. And they were really proactive and of the same position we have, organizing meeting with us, parallel meeting, inviting other states, etc., to promote that. But once adopted by the General Assembly, nobody wanted the treaty in France. And everybody starts saying, no, 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 this treaty is not good for France. No, no, we cannot sign that. And really, it has been, you know, we have to go to the defense, to the economy, to the prime minister. It took months and months. And at the end, they say, oh, you know, we cannot sign alone this treaty. It should be adopted at the European level, you know, because otherwise it will be negative for economy. And say, oh, yes, good. And this was really, then we have to mobilize once again all our activists. And we have really very strong mobilization, you know, very big campaign in the media. We organize press conference, media kits, etc. And, you know, this is one of the examples of the mobilization we had, because one of the opposing, this was in front of the Russian embassy in Paris, because, you know, Russia was against, China was against, many people were US, more or less. But we really have to mobilize in order for the treaty to be adopted, ratified in France. And at the end, even the European adopted. The problem is that today, in terms of implementation, when you see how France continues to sell to Saudi Arabia with what is happening in Yemen, to Egypt with what's happening in this country, but there are not the only cases. And I don't know if you saw yesterday, but the UN put the coalition that is led by the Saudi Arabia on Yemen, they put it on the blacklist because of war crime they are committing. And now we are, for years, asking for an embargo on arms on those countries. But we will do it. We will achieve it. And if you want to join, welcome. Okay. Then, regarding corporation and human rights, we start working and on the abuses committed by state. Then we expand it to armed group, okay, because we can realize that if the main conflict before during the Cold War were between states, etc., the influence or the impact of the armed group is very important, and there are also committing abuses. Of course, today, you know, when you look at what is happening, for instance, with Boko Haram, with Daesh, etc., we are, you know, the level, it's very, very high. Nevertheless, we consider that the one who has ratified and who have to implement the treaty and to protect their citizens are the states. Okay, but anyway, we work also on armed group and a corporation, because we don't have to forget that a state has to respect, of course, the treaties, but this is not his only responsibility. The state has to protect us against the abuses others are committing against us. It's not just to say, oh, we didn't apply, abuse, force, etc. But when someone is kidnapped, is the obligation of the state to protect him. When someone is killed, when a woman is raped, you know, is the obligation of the state to respect that. If it doesn't follow his obligation, if he doesn't protect the people, he is failing and is accountable for that. Okay, and this is something important. If you consider, for instance, the convention on a subject, okay, we don't have time to discuss, and this is a subject by itself, about the refugee issue. You know, refugee, we most of the time, as Western people, we consider that refugee, they can ask asylum when they are persecuted because of their political opinion. No, the convention is very clear. Is any person who is in danger because of the action of his government, on government, or because his government is not protecting this person, okay? And is I will take the case of forced marriage, for instance. If a woman is at risk to be married, and if she is 12 and the future husband is 50, etc., you can imagine what this means for her. And if the state is not in the position to protect her, she is allowed to ask for asylum in another country. And here also is the point, is this responsibility is very clear. And the question of corporation is, it's simple. Here, you know, I think, I don't have my glasses, but yeah, you know, if we take the 100 more powerful at the economical level, you have half country and half corporation. And those corporations today, you know, are committing abuses and very tough abuses. Is the case, okay, one of the most known case is the case of Bhopal. Over 30 years, 20,000 people have been died. Still now, over 150,000 people, there are serious disabilities because of the intoxication, because one of, not only, you know, people, the victim of this catastrophe, I will say, they have not been fairly, you know, the responsibility of the people who are at the origin of this disaster never have been judged. The reparation, it was very low, but on top of that, they never clean up the area. It means people continue to live there. Water continue to be polluted. It's a disaster, and this is continuing. And why is continuing? Because most of the time we can see that, you know, even there are local law who will allow to prosecute those people, in fact, because of corruption, because of personal interest, because of other reasons, pressure, etc., justice. You know, and you know, this is you have the other example of the Trafigura. Here it's another case on Ivory Coast, and you know, it's a company in Europe who send all the comment on appelle ça, the déchets, maybe so. Waste, yes, toxic waste, and they were sent to Ivory Coast. Here in Europe, you know, the conditions for storage, destruction, etc., were too strict. Then they considered that it was too expensive. They sent it to Ivory Coast. They put it there on the land. The people living around there were completely intoxicated. And then it was very, very difficult to go to justice because the government there, it was, you know, with all political problems, etc., in the country, nobody took care about those people, and we are still fighting for justice there. But there are many other cases. And what we can see, it's in fact that we can have mechanisms when it comes from the state, but when it comes to corporation, this is very, very difficult. Why is it difficult? It's Ah, we, no, those are just examples too of severe abuses. One of the main sectors we are working on is the extractive sector. Why the extractive sector? It's considered, I don't remember the exact number, but I think almost one third of the abuse, human rights abuses committed by corporations, there are by extractive sector. Okay, why? Because the first one is land is involved. It means that there are eviction, but also a problem of contamination most of the time. Okay, they take not only the land but very often the water. And in order to, as they don't consult, they don't go to the process that normally they should. You know, there is a reaction from the population. You can imagine what's happened if you are, because they are going to open a mine just to, where you are living, and they say, now you go away and you take your family and you forget your land. And we don't care what is going to happen with you. And then, of course, the people, they react. And then they start sending, you know, they start sending first sometime the police, just to say, to try to down the demonstration, etc. But when it doesn't work, they send the army, and then they send paramilitaries, and it ends with a very unsafe and difficult situation. And one of the most, the main people that are at risk in those situations are indigenous people. Why indigenous people? Because most of the time they don't have there are not you know, administratively proprietary of their land. You know, they have been there for centuries. It was their land, and it's very easy for them to, for the state, for instance, to send the land to sell the land to a corporation, saying, "Oh, it's owned by nobody." But they were there, and in terms of, if you look the text, for instance, on the International Organization of Labor, and this is the Article 169 that really established the right of the indigenous people on their land with specific rights and a very strong right, but no, it's just a few countries has ratified this, and then state sell the lands, and those people, they don't have, you know, any way to go to justice because they are not proprietary of the land. Is one of the problems right now, for instance, we have one case that is pretty famous in several countries, less in France, but in many countries, is the case of the Mapuche regarding the question of the Benetton. Okay, they acquire, I think it's 1 million hectares for the lamb and the wool. And a part of the land they have acquired it's from Mapuche indigenous. And there has disappeared 2 months ago an activist. And this is the other aspect, the human rights defender and the activist, they defend those rights. And Santiago Maldonado, we have a very, very strong mobilization. And in fact, when we go to the human rights defender of the land and the water, today they are the most criminalized in the world because it's directly related to the activities of the corporation. They are really criminalized. And also is the most, I will say, the biggest number it's in Latin America, and also is where we have today, in terms of human rights defender, the biggest number of people who has been killed. One of the symbol of this is Berta Cáceres in Honduras. She was killed, I don't remember if it was 1 or 2 years ago, and she was fighting to protect the right of her community regarding a mining project. Okay? Okay, what we call for from Amnesty, of course, is the prevention. And there are, we promote the fact that, you know, the right of the people has to be really prevented and addressed. It's not, you know, very often we see that corporations, they have ethical chart, you know, ethical declaration, etc. But and also corporate social responsibility report. And they do things that they are wonderful, you know. They build schools, they build hospitals. What we are asking here is that for them to study their impact and to prevent the abuses. It's easy to say, oh, we have a school. The problem is that if, you know, the village, the water is contaminated, the people, they cannot, there is no more road, they have no more house. Okay, it's nice to build school, but this is not the main issue, you know. The main issue is when you initiate a business, you know, to be sure that the impact will not be negative on the people. And if it has negative impact, then you to work with them to see how to overpass and to compensate that. You know, because there is really how we discuss with them, we work with them, because it's not to be against development. It's just to be sure that, you know, just a few are going to take advantage of this and the others will have a negative impact, because then is where you create conflict. They have to be accountable for what they do, okay, and not just, it's not our fault, because the state where they operate is not taking them accountable. The remedy for the people, and it's not just the money, it's also to clean up the area, it's also to rebuild what has been destroyed, etc. And also, it's not to say, oh, here in France, we are fine, because we have very strong law. But when we are abroad, when we are far, or we don't see what's happened, and we let operate the company and doing really conducting abuses. Then, and here is very interesting, because when we see, okay, we can speak about globalization, and we can see that most of corporation has been really advocating to for strong regulation in terms of tax issue, in terms of free trade, in terms when it's they consider is to their benefit, okay, they are very strong in lobbying to obtain such a regulation. But we can see that when it comes to protect environment, when it comes to protect human rights, they say, oh no, we don't need hard law, okay, what we need is soft law. It means that what we are looking for is for guidelines, directive, you know, things that they give us the direction how to do it well or good, but without any obligation, without any accountability. And we can see that at the different level, now for years, people have been fighting in order to put in place some regulation, some binding, but at this moment, we didn't really achieve that. And we have the Global Compact, no, the UN Guiding Principle. This is from Roger, no, I don't know if you never heard about this. No, in fact, the guiding principle is on the basis of what we are asking for, you know, to prevent, remedy, etc., accountability, remedy, etc. But we have a very nice guide how to implement, but that's it. In the local law, nothing, you know, there is no obligation. It's really non-binding. They create the Global Compact Initiative. It's very nice. And, you know, the company who wants to be part of this, they have to commit to improve what they do, etc. But, okay, here again, it's non-binding. And when you see the company who are member of the Global Compact, okay, you say, why? But we have many reports that, you know, shows that they are committing abuses, or they are not, or letting abuses committed by people who operate with them. At the OCDE also, you have, you know, guidelines with national contact point, but here again, it's not legally binding, it's just, you know, they give you very nice guidelines how to implement. At the EU, We have the directive. The directive, I don't know if you are familiar with the European system, but directive is kind of guideline, and it asks to the different country to implement in a period of time, but it's just a guideline and it's very different from one country to another. And at the end, you know, the implementation of the you know, the disclosure of non-financial information on the corporation report, it's very wide, and state they don't really are very demanding regarding this, and it's even very difficult to obtain law and robust law on that. Then we have UK Modern Slavery Act. It's a due diligence process here again. It's good practice how to implement. And of course, all the time, corporations say, yes, but let us do it, because we, if you give us guidelines, we will implement. Trust us. Okay. We are trusting them for years now, and not only years, for decades, okay? And what is the result? I just took, this is the 10 principles of the Global Compact, okay? And you can see that you have human rights, labor, environment, anti-corruption. And anti-corruption, yes, I will talk of this. This really, we have very binding law, and not only in Europe. But the other aspect, it's quite, you know, it's most of the time, it's just a guideline, and companies, they don't really care. Even though this is part of most of the ethical chart we can find on the website of the company, okay? Everybody's talking about this, but, and this is my point, if you take the case of slavery, this is easy to prove. All those companies, all those corporations are claiming that they are against slavery. Where are we today? Okay, this is the result that, you know, it's the last study that it was disclosed by the International Organization of Labor, and a number, it, you know, for 2016, you know, we have 25 million people considered to work, no, not to work, to be in a modern slavery system. Just for you to know, in 2015, it was 19 million. It means that this has increased by 25% in 1 year. Okay? And when you see that the main sector, except the people working at domestic level, you know, it's manufacturing, agriculture, construction, entertainment, you have some question. And to 25 million, you have to add the 15 million forced marriage person. And in fact, they consider as a whole 40 million people to be in a form of modern slavery. 70% of those are women. And a big number are children. And, you know, what is also terrifying is that you can see that among the 168 million of children that are working, this was a number in 2012, and we know this has increased dramatically. You know, 85 million, it was in dangerous work. We have a campaign, for instance, regarding the mining of cobalt and some mineral in Democratic Republic of Congo, because on some mining, they can send only children, and this is very dangerous, it's very toxic, etc. And there is where they send the children. And this is really awful. But when corporations are claiming that, you know, in their ethical chart, that there are, you know, fighting against slavery and child labor, what do you think when you know that they are buying the cobalt and other mining, or palm oil, or is the case of the cacao in Ivory Coast, etc., and those products are used by huge company like Samsung, and I will go back to Samsung, like Apple. Today, you know, in the UK, they are promoting the electric car to protect the environment, you know. But the battery of those cars are produced with mineral coming from the mining in Democratic Republic of Congo, extracted by young children working those conditions. Then how those companies, they agree on soft law, they agree on those ethical chart, they agree on those principles. They are saying, just to give us guidelines and we will do the job, how they are doing it. And for this reason, we are asking for hard law. And here you have the state, okay, with the highest people of modern slavery. Bangladesh. Bangladesh is the Rana Plaza. Bangladesh. But we continue to produce. When we are speaking about the Bangladesh and the Rana Plaza, what we are asking is not to say that don't go anymore to Bangladesh to produce the goods. This is not the issue, okay? Because we know that if we stop producing there, some people, the people they need this money, they need to work. The issue is not to say don't send it there. The issue is to tell them, when you ask your supplier to produce this piece, these pants, or these shoes, etc., not to reduce again 10% more, because when you are going to reduce that, it's not only the salary of the people you are going to reduce, it's the safety of the installation, it's the quality insurance system, and the negative impact will be for them, because all the people taking the margin from the, you know, from the one who is manufacturing, the one who is going to distribute, the one who is going to sell, to promote, etc., they are going to keep the margin. The reduction will be on those people. And this is what we are asking. And this is also, I really consider that as a customer, we have an obligation and a responsibility. And then I am going to... 10 minutes more. Then just a case. This is, and if I speak about the Rana Plaza, is because, you know, with other NGOs in France, we have obtained this year, in March 2017, the first regulation, the first law, binding law, okay, even if it's not criminalizing the corporation, but it's the first binding law that it takes into consideration all the value chain, okay? And we start, this is the people who were, who have been working on this. It was first a coalition of different NGOs. You have here, Amnesty International and the other, the CCFD. It's, I don't know how it's called in English, but it's working, more on economical, social, cultural rights, and also we work on this with unions, and this was very, very important, because when you are working on such a regulation, you know, the first thing a corporation says that, oh, this is going to be against our competition strengths, you know. If you ask us to have such a tough regulation, you know, we are going to lose market, and then we are going to have to fight people here in France and to have the union with us to respect the rights of the workers in other countries, in the condition they work. It was really important. Then we have three main MPs. In fact, there were Daniel Leroy, it's from the Green Party, and the other two from the Socialist Party, and the last one, he left the Socialist Party. The draft of the project was written by the clinic of the Law School of Sciences Po. And okay, we had a lot of lobbying. But just to let you know how we deal with this. In fact, we start with the first seminar at the National Assembly. Our concern was really not to make only corporations accountable and responsible for what they do, but also the supplier or the different entity they work with. And with the idea is that if you are the one to give the order, you have to ensure that all the people who are going to work on the value chain will be responsible. This is something, it works in other kind of sector, but regarding social responsibility, it was really very negative. We cannot be accountable for that. Okay, I am coming from the pharmaceutical industry. I can tell you that if tomorrow a pharmaceutical company here in France goes to India, China, or whatever, to buy, for instance, a raw material, they will send, you know, the quality insurance team that is going to look, to ask, to, and you know, it's really a complete audit to be sure that they comply with the quality insurance system. Of course, because, and I am maybe quite cynic when I say that, but because it will impact on health, okay? And then we have very strict law, and in this case, they can do it. And nobody's saying that it's against the competitivity of the European corporation, okay? But in this case, it's worked. Why we cannot audit and validate when it comes, you know, to other sectors that will impact the life of the people where it's produced? This is the point. Then we start with this, and we have different case studies. We have been working for a year now, the case of Shell in Nigeria. I don't know if you are aware of this case. It's about the oil contamination in the delta of Niger. It's an awful situation, and for years Shell doesn't want to recognize and doesn't want to clean up the area, and it's very, very difficult. Then we have the case of Trafigura, I just spoke, Bhopal. And in March 2013, we have the case of Rana Plaza. And Rana Plaza was really a shock here because it was almost, I think, almost 1,000 people who died because of the collapse of the building where they were producing clothes that they were sold in shops here. This was really, really a shock. And when the law was adopted, this is 2013, 4 years later, it's still called the Rana Plaza Law. Because it was, because companies here were saying, oh, no, we are not responsible. We cannot be accountable. We cannot indemnify the victims because it's the supplier responsibility. And the supplier was saying, no, but they imposed this price, they imposed this condition, and they didn't want to be accountable. And then who was accountable for that? Okay, the transporter? Oh. Then, you know, this was really the Wi-Fi. It was, at the beginning, it was the government. So we were with the socialist government. They were in favor. But when we start lobbying at the different ministries, etc., they start saying, oh, regarding corporation. And we saw that the lobby of the main, the biggest corporation in France started opposing that. And the government said, oh, no, it's too, what you want is too negative for the company. It's going to decrease, here again, their competitiveness. Then we have three projects, you know, because as the project couldn't be applied by the government, you know, it is the process that is very complicated, but each of those, they applied separately for a project of law, crossing their finger that one of them will be passed to the filter. Finally, the government really opposed, and we had a very, very, very hard corporation lobby. Okay, and at that time, the Minister of Economy was our new elected president, Mr. Macron, who was really against and against how we can put any hard law on corporation, how we can have any obligation. We have to let them operate because corporation, they are not bad. They are good people and they want to do good things. Okay, but we had a Rana Plaza. Okay, and but anyway, and here is when we had really, really hard activism and a lot of media work. We organized tour of people coming from Rana Plaza seminar in the National Assembly, people coming from Bhopal, people coming from Ivory Coast, Trafigura, people coming from Nigeria to expose, you know, the difficulty, the case, etc. With media, really very, very hard work on that. We have a lot of support. For instance, we have almost a big part of the Nicolas Hulot, who is the Minister for Environment, you know, at that time organized a big meeting, okay, I will say a show, but we have a special place there to present the project, etc. And we have a lot of work on social media, etc., etc., etc. Really, we have to push very hard with short video on internet, digital communication. Really, we invest a lot on this campaign. And several meetings at the different ministries in front of the people from the lobbies, etc. And involve. And at the end, okay, we had a new project in 2014, we continue, and the law was adopted in February, in March this year. But really, it has been, you know, in terms of confrontation with the lobbying, confrontation with the people supporting and the corporation, and I don't know if we can speak about support, but okay, the first project was more ambitious, okay? But you know, it's like when you try to sell something, you put your foot into the door, and then you try to enter yourself. But we have the first foot. However, this is the first binding law, due diligence, that involves corporate social responsibility. It means that include all the chain, including the suppliers abroad. It means that they are responsible. What the company they have, exactly, for instance, like the pharmaceutical industry, they have to really monitor and guarantee that you know, they manage all the risk. And if there is a failure, if there is an accident, of course, if they did everything in terms of managing the risk, they will not be taken accountable for that. But if it can be proven that they didn't manage correctly the risk, they didn't have this due diligence process, they can have fine up to 10 million. It's a huge advance in terms of the law in France. Nevertheless, if we have to look at what's happened with the Rana Plaza, this will not apply. Why? Because most of the companies that were involved of that, the number of employees were below 5,000. And then it's we know that, you know, this is going to it concerns only 150, 200 corporations in France. It's very low. And, you know, there will not be criminal responsibility for what is done. But it's the first time they can be accountable for what can be abroad on human rights. Because, you know, we have, you know, all the time they say, we cannot apply these things because this is very limiting. If you take the case, and this is where it comes from the General Data Protection Regulation. You know, I told you regarding human rights and social responsibility, this is directive. Directive means that, as I told you, that each state is kind of guidelines for them to adopt a law. In this case, it's a European regulation. It means that this applies to all the 28 European states, May 2018, the same date, is the same regulation. A regulation has the value of law in Europe. It means that there is no specific. They can adapt, but it can be more strict, no less strict. Okay? And this is really important. It means that it can be done. It applies to personal data. And this is a very good point because, and if you want, I come here just to explain about the personal data. Another day I can do it, but it's very interesting. You know, this is about the right to be forgotten, the right, the obligation of the consent, the right of portability. It's very, very important regulation and is very protective and is going to change completely the organization and has a financial fines up to 4% of the global annual turnover of a corporation. Global annual turnover. It means that here, I will say the subsidiary of Microsoft, you know, it's proven that violate the regulation is not the 4%, is not on the turnover of the French subsidiary. It's the global one. You imagine the size of the fines they can have to pay. And this is really very, very important. There is no criminal responsibility, but the fines are very, very high. And the impact on operational data and the image of reputation. Just to give you an example, as a consumer, I give my data when I fill in any loyalty card, I give some information. This is about my address, my birth date, etc. This is personal data. Okay. Today, the one who has collected sell it to someone else. We receive a lot of emailing, etc. They have to ask me if I agree they use this data. And they have also to disclose to me what they are going to do to this data. And if I don't like the company, I will say, no, I don't give you my consent. And anyway, I give it today, but tomorrow I learn that you are using children in bad condition, okay? Or you are promoting, bah, you know, you don't fight against slavery, or you are very bad with your employees. I send just a mail, I say, you have to release my consent. And they have to do it immediately. And this is changing completely the relation, you know, corporation will have with the people they are using the personal data. Because the European Union has recognized that the data belongs to the people and not to the corporation or any company that is using the data. We achieved that. Because they see a commercial advantage for that. For them, yeah.
Sorry, but once the data has already been given, what can you do?
From this company to another one.
Ah, no. It's very interesting, this point, because you give, when you give the data, now on, they, from May 25, next year, they will have to inform you who is collecting the data, who is in charge of the treatment, what is the finality, you know, the purpose of the of them to collect the data? How they are going to process the data? Okay, where they are going to process the data? Because if they send the data, for instance, to Tunisia for the call center, you know, they have to tell you to whom they send the data, and you have to give how long they are going to keep your data, and then they have to give you to whom you have to write to modify, to cancel your consent, to ask to be completely deleted, to send them all the information you know they have on you, etc. And those rights apply from the moment you know, you give your consent to them to collect. But you have to give your consent on anything they do. It means that if they collect, okay, you can say, okay, you know, I want my loyalty card, I don't know, for the FNAC, okay. And they have to clearly express what they are doing to that. They can say that they will send to other subsidiary of the group, okay. But then this subsidiary, you don't know what they are going to do that with your data. It means that, you know, when they are going to contact you, they have to inform you. But what is very important is the right they start when they collect the data. It means that at any time, you can stop the consent. At any time, you can ask them to delete all the information. There are exceptions, okay? Those exceptions is one is to implement a contract, one is because to fulfill legal obligation, etc. But, you know, at any time, you can stop your consent and you can ask them to delete, except, you know, certain conditions. And this is very strong. It means that in terms of image, tomorrow, I am unhappy what a company is doing. I send a mail and say, I don't want you to use any more my data, and you have to delete everything from me, and I want you to send me everything you have and where it is. Oui, and then you can see that this is just to show that it's possible to do it. The last point, it's about corruption, but I don't go here inside, but here again, we can see that when it comes to corruption, we can have very strong law. And this is the case of the vice chairman of Samsung, who was convinced of 5 years of imprisonment this summer, okay, and for bribery. And in this case, also it works. We can see that in some cases, criminalization can work. And just I finish with this one, okay. When we are talking about hard law, soft law, very often corporations are claiming that soft law it's against them because competitiveness, etc. This is a sentence. I was in September. I was in Shanghai, a seminar on anti-corruption and data privacy, transparency, and compliance. And on the Asia-Pacific area. And this was something an official from South Korea expressed. It said, as you see, if we want to change culture and achieve results, we need strong law with heavy sentences and high fines. Okay, thank you very much.
All right, guys. Before we start, I would like to thank you for being here. It was really good. Great presentation.
So I'm Felipe, she's Yelena, and today we're going to talk about corporate responsibility and human rights. So we are going to cover human rights in business. What are human rights? Business obligations, policy commitment, due diligence, external communications, no proper laws regarding human rights, remedy, and where are we now? First slide is about introducing human rights in business. So the office responsible for endorsing human rights, the guiding principles on business and human rights, was established in June 2011 by John Ruggie, UN Secretary General. It basically works as a global standard for all states and businesses, aiming at covering international and also domestic law. This guiding principle has three pillars as its main important topics. The first one is the state duty to protect human rights. The second one is the corporate responsibility to respect human rights. And the third one is the need for greater access to remedy for victims of business-related abuse. The blueprint, it serves as a blueprint and also, as I said, a global standard for preventing the risk of adverse human rights impacts. We're going to talk about the definition of what is an adverse human rights impact. All this linked, of course, to business activities. As John Ruggie said during the reading of this paper, the main challenge is the implementation of its pillars. As Madame Garrigos mentioned, in the Samsung example, we saw that the VP, Jay Lee, was convicted to a five-year term in jail due to bribery of government officials, and especially recently impeached President Park Geun-hye was also involved. And talking about those three pillars, when we look at the first one, which is the government to protect human rights, so how can we require this engagement from the government if he has all these shady relationships with these big corporations? So this top-down approach that we need, it's actually very hard to achieve, right? Second slide is, what are human rights? I think the main word that defines human rights is dignity. So it's basically being treated equally, no matter your nationality, ethnic origin, sex, color, or religion. As Madame Garrigos mentioned, after World War II, which I think is the lowest point that we could ever get as how we treat each other as human beings, we saw that the 1948 Declaration of Human Rights took place, and it's also considered the cornerstone of modern human rights law. Jumping from that to the sphere of work, human rights for workers, there are four main categories that I think it's worth mentioning here. The first one is the freedom of association and the right to collective bargaining. The second one is the elimination of compulsory labor. Third one, the abolition of child labor. And the fourth, the elimination of discrimination in respect of employment and occupation. Excuse me. So all these, they represent, in order to implement and achieve all these goals, there is a major difficulty that I currently see in this global scenario, which is what you mentioned, the international human rights treaties. They usually do not impose legal obligations on business enterprises. So the enforcement of international human rights has to be done by national law. So all these companies operating in these third world countries and doing all these terrible things, they are not, according to the human rights treaties, they are not legally, they cannot be held legally responsible for what they're doing. So there is I think this is the hardest task of the Amnesty and also other organizations in order to hold them accountable. So business obligations. Enterprises, they are directly responsible for their business activities and effects on its people, and also the community in which they operate. As an example, if you see a mine polluting the water source of a local community, that breaks the OECD's guideline for multinational enterprises. So the company will suffer financial and possible reputational consequences, and that can be expressed in different forms, such as future permits, project opportunities, retaining staff, and etc. But as a question for you, Madame Garrigos, if you can answer after we finish our presentation, is okay, they lose prestige, they lose credibility, they might lose a lot of money. But as I said before, how can we hold them accountable for what they're doing legally under the law of the country, I suppose, that they are operating? So now we're going to talk about adverse human rights impact. The definition of that term occurs when an action removes or reduces the ability of an individual to enjoy his or her human rights. So here I have a personal short story for you guys. Last year I was working in a multinational company in Brazil. they're everywhere in the world. They're really big. And I had a very good friend. She was recently promoted to a senior leadership position. And she was a great person, super, very competent. So she was trying to engage with the senior leadership in order to get things going, right? So she set up a lunch with a director there. And while they were eating, like, the guy just laid his hand on top of hers and made some bad comments. And she was so shocked that she left the restaurant, didn't know what to do. And she was telling me that later, and she was terrified. She didn't know, she was new also in that position. So she really didn't know what to do, who to tell. And we had our whistleblower department inside the company. But all those people, they were actually very good friends with this man. So she knew that nothing would happen. So basically, she didn't do anything. And I'm sure that has been happening again to other women inside the company. So that's just a quick story. And there are other examples that we can relate to the violation of someone's human rights. And they are very diverse. They can go from, as an example, providing data about internet services users to a government that used the data to trace and prosecute political dissidents contrary to human rights. They can go from this to targeting high sugar food and drinks at children with an impact on child obesity. So the set that human rights covers is very broad. So we can address a lot of important social issues. So policy commitment. Policy commitment is regarding what the business should have in place regarding their policies and processes appropriate to their size and circumstances. They must identify, prevent, and mitigate any violation on human rights. And I think the hardest stage on this process is the mitigation. As I just mentioned, what happened to my colleague, I think that's where things just end and they don't actually take place. So this approach, this policy commitment must be an active and ongoing effort, not a passive one. The company or enterprise need transparency internally and also externally in order to show its commitments to human rights. As an example to show that transparency, they can engage with the civil society in which they are operating. They can engage with national human rights organizations, with the academia, to have their guidance and advice on their processes. The main areas in which human rights are usually violated are production, human resources, procurement, and sales. Here we have BlueScope. It's an Australian company in the steel industry, and that's an example of a policy commitment. So in this policy commitment, it mentions some phrases such as efficient use of resources. We strive to be valued corporate citizens. We respect the values and cultural heritage of local people. We report, assess, and manage health, security, environment, and community risks and incidents. And we all know that usually it's not what happens, right? Now, due diligence. So as we mentioned before, we have to identify, prevent, and mitigate any violation of human rights. But due diligence is more about accountability. It's holding someone accountable for what, or some entity for what they have caused or done. So it's basically acting upon the findings, tracking responses, and communicating how impacts are addressed. Due diligence is mainly related to business operations, but also it can relate to the company's products and services. It's if it it's a very important, if not the most important step into this process, because it's when we have to take action. And as I said before, it's usually where things just fall apart. So regarding due diligence, we can have, in regarding stakeholders, we can have a very broad conflict of interest. We can have biased judgment. We can have corruption or bribery, like the Samsung case. And we can have budgeting and resources problems. As I mentioned in the company where I was working, the department that was responsible for this, for taking care of these types of abuse, was, no one knew about it. Like, it was really small. They pay no attention to it. They never gave us any information about it. So I think that regards budgeting and resources. So now Yelena is gonna talk to you guys about some current events that are taking place.
Thank you, Felipe. Felipe introduced us with some theoretical backgrounds, and now we will see also some parts and continue with due diligence. And after that, you will see some practical also examples. This that you can see, it's from that United Nations guide that we saw also from the previous parts, United Nations guide on corporate responsibility and human rights. One of the most guidelines that companies should follow are that a company should be a source of continuous learning, and it should learn from its own mistakes or mistakes of another companies and business partners. That also all the personnel needs to have awareness and to know exactly what is the company's policy. Another guideline that companies should follow is that companies definitely should seize and prevent any impact that is harmful or that is bad regarding the human rights. Also, it's very important, and you will see later particularly why, that companies should track the effectiveness of their response. Usually it depends on the situation and on the company, but it's suggested that the company should choose the best option how to track the impact and the effectiveness of the response from some feedback of the social community that was impacted or from some different reports. Also usage of different experts and or guides. One of the interesting thing that is mentioned in this guide is that companies can use leverage. It's leverage in a mean that companies can and should be able to affect in different ways also their business partners. And like I said, later we will see why is that important. As you can see from the picture, this was a model that was in the United Nations Guide for Human Rights. And it shows that if a company has a crucial business relationship with another company that's making this bad impact or doesn't respect the human rights, there are some guidelines that a company could follow. So if it's a crucial business relationship and company could have certain impact or leverage, then it should try to stop it. Or if that is unsuccessful, the company doesn't really have a proper leverage and it should try to increase it. Or if it's non-crucial relationship, usually it's suggested for a company to try to again make a better leverage or to completely stop this type of the relationship. Of course, the another important thing is to communicate externally. Why it's really, really important to stress that companies need to communicate externally what are they doing and to put that in different reports. This was really, really good way explained in the non-financial reporting directive that was mentioned before. That was from European Union, and this was very welcome on the website of the Amnesty. We found a lot of supporting of this particular directive, which states that member states of European Union should and need to disclose information on in their impact on society, human rights, environment, and other areas, which you can see from the really nice picture that was made. And if you look on the bottom, or the red part that we made on the picture, you can see that it's also very important for companies to externally communicate everything that happens, not just in the company and what the company directly does, but also what happens in their own supply chain and what happens with the subcontracting chain. We will see later, which also it's connected to what happened in Rana Plaza. So what was criticized about this directive was that it missed practical guidelines and some guidelines how companies should deal with resource efficiency indicators and how to implement better practices. So one of the very important guidelines in this United Nations guide was number 31, which states that in general cases, all the companies should follow and need to follow international laws and to behave according to international laws. But as Philippe mentioned, the national laws are also important. But we were asking ourselves, what if there are not a proper national laws? Or if there are laws, but they are not implemented properly, or the governments are corrupted, as many times happens. So, as it was mentioned, this happened in Dhaka district in Bangladesh, which was the building of Rana Plaza, which collapsed and had a lot of casualties, more than 1,000, and 2,500 people injured. The owner of this Rana Plaza was somehow connected to the government and some sort of parties. So it was very difficult for government to actually prosecute him. And he, in the end, got only, after some time, 3 years in jail. There are 39 world brands that were involved in this in Rana Plaza workers in this case. I'm saying this because in many cases we have seen that people say that they don't want to shop in Primark and in brands like this as they participate in Rana Plaza, but there are many other brands that are not she brands, but they also had their participation there and they've done mostly nothing even today, even to recognize that it was their fault. So the owner was only 3 years in prison, and the government tried to enforce the companies, as also NGOs, an important international organization, to enforce the companies to sign the agreements. You will be surprised, as I was, that Walmart was one of the first ones to say no. They didn't recognize any agreements, they didn't want to put any better conditions for the workers, and only Primark actually decided to provide some sort of money and to get certain things back to victims, but only to the victims that could provide DNA evidence that their family members were there. And as you can see, that was $200. Yeah, there is these suggestions we made about the movie The True Cost. It's a really good movie, and we suggest you to really look at it because it shows not only Rana Plaza, it shows also that how bad conditions were about these workers, as you can see on the picture. And these people were working for less than 40 euros a month. And that is actually with the government proposal of the increase of 70%. So it's difficult to find this data, but we don't know how lower they're really paid and in these conditions. Thank you. So the another example that we saw was the UK company, Royal Dutch Shell, that this case is actually still ongoing. There was some settlements, and you can see from the picture how Bodo Creek looked like, and it was mostly a fisherman place, and how it looks now, or how it actually looked after the two oil spills, one in August and one December 2008. So almost 9 years later, there wasn't any proper remedy to this, especially endogenous people that we heard are mostly jeopardized. So, thank you. Another example, unfortunately, was that we found a really good data on is Trafigura, the Singapore company. that, as we also heard of, was the case of the city of Abidjan, the Ivory Coast, in August 2006, when 528 cubic meters of toxic waste was put on different locations. And after that, 100,000 people needed a medical treatment, and you can see how bad that affected and how bad that looked like. And again, it's a really problematic to get the remedy to these people, to make companies to clean this. And most of these cases are still happening, and usually just are, like Philippe said, just money settlements. The another case was actually a French company, Total, who was accused of forced labor and human rights violations in Myanmar. As you can see, that sometimes French people like to make funny jokes about it, but they were really accused of really making a military regime in Myanmar. The case was dropped by the Belgium courts for bit of a strange reason, that it was non-Belgian national status, but there was some sort of a settlement around 5 million euros. So when we talked about that, Philippe mentioned about the three pillars, and one of the important ones is remedy. This was a case that we also heard about before, about Bhopal in India in 1984. This place was called the place of many lakes before this happens. This was Union Carbide was a company that made a mistake. The workers made a mistake, and there was a gas leak. After which water is went polluted, and as you can see, that 20,000 people died, and after that 500,000 stayed with injuries. And 25 years later, the Indian court, only 25 years later, the Indian court convicted some of them. But we found also on Amnesty website some really good interviews with the victims that stated that it's not just that they were survivors of this particular event. They are still as victims of the remedy being too late, of things not be cleaned as the water is still polluted. And one lady actually stated that that her children, female children, have problems of now having their own children because they were really, really being under the water and resources that are polluted. So Union Carbide refused to disclose any details which were necessary for a proper medical treatment. So we decided to propose also a question that we thought, usually people mention that these things happen in the third world countries and that human rights are not respected mostly there. We don't really think that much about not respecting human rights in first world countries. But there is a great example of the human right on a clean water and clean conditions, which there is no mention of in the US Bill of Rights. There are many other rights mentions, even including about the soldiers, but there are no mention of a human right, basic right on clean water. And we also wanted to state that we were thinking, what is the proper way to measure these impacts, and which one is the, as it's stated in the guide of United Nations, which one is the most important one? How we address which one we do first, like which one the institutions should go first and solve first, and which one is less important? Thank you. So when it's a question about what happens today, in 2017, we was mentioned before the key factors that from 100 biggest economies, 51 are corporations and 49 are countries. So today, hopefully, we are moving towards hard laws, less than now we are on the soft laws. But there will be an index developed that is a corporate human right benchmark. It will be collected and published in 2018. On the different companies and how do they protest and do with human rights. Also, we have seen and mentioned the European Union non-financial directive. There is also a French bill on corporate due diligence that was brought in 2013, but only passed in Parliament 2015. And there is a US Business Supply Chain Transparency on Trafficking and Slavery Act from 2015. up to this day, the most prominent and used instruments are still UN guides, like UN Global Compact, UN Guiding Principles on Business and Human Rights, and OECD guidelines for multinational companies. And most of them are just mere suggestions and just guidelines and really, really soft law instruments. And yeah, these are our references, and that's it. Thank you.
Congratulations. Thank you. Well, merci. Yeah. Then you asked me first question, how can take them accountable under national law? In fact, it depends on national law. Okay. If you take the case of your friends, this is sexual harassment. Sexual harassment at work. It's criminalized in France. You can go to court. Difficult one. But you have a law on that. There are countries where it doesn't exist. Then you don't have the protection of law, and it's by far more difficult. The question is that in many cases, for instance, if you take the case of slavery, I think except Mauritania, you know, or other countries, it's a crime, slavery. Quite often, the problem is the independence of the justice, is the fact that in several countries you have corruption, and it's even difficult to have a fair trial. The other aspect is that most of the time, people who suffer those abuses are people vulnerable. They don't know the right. They are many times also poor. They don't have the money to go to the lawyer. And then it's even more difficult. You know, we are really in a case of intersectional, you know, violation. And this is the reason why when it's at a corporation level, it's very important to have unions and to have independent systems. If you take the case of the sexual harassment, for instance, I think it's France, but it's at the European level, corporations have the obligation to have an external system where the people, they can denounce the case of sexual harassment, but also if there are, not only if there are victims, but also the cases of racism, sexism, xenophobia, political, etc., any discrimination, but they can, they have a call number where they can call. And this is very important because you can have also harassment, many issues. And then it's those people to investigate, you know, the case, etc. And the question, and we can see that when we are talking regarding the worker of the corporation, at least in France, you have several systems, you can apply, you know, special code, the prud'homme, etc. But we can see that year after year, you know, even in France, in order to improve the system, okay, there are limiting the system. For instance, you know, in the case of harassment, sexual abuse, etc., you could go first to the health doctor. You have labor medicine. Okay, this is disappearing now. The problem there are decreasing the financing. You know, all the system that they can provide justice, or at least you can apply to, there are decreasing. Then there is a really concern, and it's needed. We be careful of that. Regarding big abuses in terms of, as you saw on Boko Haram, etc., of course, Nigeria has, you know, a strong regulation about what is happening in the Delta of Niger. Okay, it's not they don't have regulation about the contamination by all the forced eviction, etc. The problem is that the system is really very much corrupted. Okay, because and we know what's happened there. And then it's how, if at the local level you don't have the appropriate law or a fair justice system, how you can go to another jurisdictional system. And for this reason, it's also important to have hard law, because when you have law, it's easier, you know, to apply for justice, but and you can go abroad. Otherwise, it becomes very difficult. Okay, but you know, and the first thing is to reinforce the law, and it's this reason, the reason why we are so much advocating and mobilized to develop law and to reinforce law system. Sexual harassment is a very, very, very difficult issue, and sexism is a very, very difficult issue, and this is a subject by itself, because in fact, and in this particular case, well, no, it's not a particular case, the sexual harassment, the problem is any sexual aggression against women generate first, it's very destroying for the woman who is victim of that, and also she feels comment dit honte?
Shame.
Yeah, she feels shame herself when it should be the perpetrator. But and it's difficult to talk, etc. And this is used in many companies, you know, in order to keep this kind of domination in women. But it's for this reason. Here again, we need laws. Otherwise, nobody take care of this. Directive, plus définition et demande. Yeah, regarding the European directive, of course, we were very happy with the content, what they asked to disclose in the reporting, okay? Because it's exactly what we were asking. What is your impact on, what is the impact on of your business on the different stakeholders, but and what are the measures you are taking? What it makes us less happy is there is no real obligation and it's not really binding. It's just guidelines, and now it's the first step, because at least they recognize this is the way we have to work on, but how now, how we implement that and not just recommend. And the third point regarding just another comment on Union Carbide, you know, some people from Union Carbide India, they went to court, but the people who were responsible, they went back to the US. Union Carbide was sold out to Dow Chemical. They lost completely who was in charge, the responsibility, etc. And for during all those years, they have been asking, you know, the Indian court has been asking and calling for the US responsible of that to come to the US, to India, just to explain, to confront with what's happened with the a lawyer of the victim, etc., and they always refused, and they don't have any means to obtain, they come to India. And this was really a big disaster. But thank you very much, it was really, we have the same cases still, thank you. And your questions now?
is still the same. You can tell us from which section you are.
Okay, so you start.
I don't think so, but I think we understand each other.
Qu'est-ce que tu veux que je fasse?
For the people on the back.
Oh, okay. Okay, perfect. Yeah. Sorry. I'm Luca. I'm from Option A, Innovation and Innovation Policies. And I would like to share more, like make more a comment on self-commitment, reporting, and CSR, which I think is a really nice concept in theory. But if you look at it in practice, also especially when you look at the reportings of the Global Compact, it's mainly a greenwashing tool for big companies, because of course big companies, they can have a big CSR department where they have a lot of resources and make like really nice, colorful, beautiful reports. From my own experience, I can say we work together with Students Association. We work together with the Global Compact Germany, and we were actually starting to read the reports of progress of SMEs, which are normally not read. And actually, when you read them, there's not much, actually. Like, when they write about human rights, they actually write about, I know, ergonomic chairs for the workers. That's like things they write on human rights. So actually, there's not a big understanding in general, in the core of what are the matters in the supply chain. So there's still a lot of ignorance. Exactly. And another experience, I was also working in a consulting agency for SMEs to help them actually to write those reportings. And for example, the GRI reporting guideline is like 1,500 pages. And it was like a lot of work for me to read it, and I couldn't like imagine, I know, a small business to read all through that and like actually do a good reporting. So I think CSR works only for big companies to greenwash, or if CSR is really adapted on the management level. Like if you have maybe the CEO who's really passionate about human rights and about like a responsible way of management, but otherwise I don't really see CSR working as a tool. And maybe you can share your view on that.
Yeah, what is interesting with the Global Compact, because I did my test by myself, I went to visit them, etc. And it's very interesting because what they ask you is to identify, you know, two of the 10 points, you know, where you think you can improve, and to define a plan to improve, and 1 year later, what you did and what was the result. And then, okay, it's not enough, that for sure. And you decide what you are going to improve. But this is the problem of the soft law and the guidelines. We need to be more tough. You know, you take a case, is the equality in terms of salary, women and men, okay? We have a law. We should have the same salary for women and men at the same level for the same task. Okay, we know that even in the Finland and Norway, where we have the highest rate in the world, there is a difference of 15%. Okay, and at the end, Iceland, I cannot say that Iceland is more a liberal country, I will say. Okay, Iceland decide to have a law with high fines to oblige the company to respect the quality. It means that, you know, we need, at some point, we need that, okay? And I agree with you, it depends so much about the CEO, about the how they comply with that, and for some of them, they understand that it's also good for their business. It's just not for ethical reason, but there are just a few. When they can hide, they do it.
I'm Afroza from Option C, and I'm from Bangladesh. And yeah, so I have two questions and one comment. So first question about, you said about the training and education program that Amnesty International that, so it will be good if you want to elaborate more like how they do it, especially in terms of their conflict situation sometimes, and especially you said that you guys also work on like the people who are in like a prison and also like a refugee. So with those kind of people, how your program is like conducted, because they are not stable in one place. So it will be good if you elaborate it more. And another question is about like a recent issue about like Myanmar Rohingya things. So how this your Amnesty International is looking this fact. And another comment is regarding like Rana Plaza, that you said about there is a lots of law is like implementing. The thing is like whether, there is a law, but the thing is like if you look into this garment factory and also worker situation, it's not improving. So when you're like pressurizing those people, especially those, the owner of the companies, so how they do, like it's kind of anyhow it's gonna be effect to the workers rather than their profit margin or whatever. So sometimes I feel like that, okay, those kind of law, okay, they are doing it's fine, but like how you're auditing it, that is also very important. Otherwise, it's gonna be really, really harmful effect to the people who are working. Mm. Yeah, thank you.
Mm. Okay, the educational program Amnesty is doing, it's different from one country to another, okay? And each section of Amnesty, we have educational program that is issued from our Norway section, and they are very good at that, and it's by digital program. But we have in different sections, different program. Some people, they go more to the refugee people for them to learn their right. In some cases, it's more women rights. It really depends. For instance, in Paraguay, we do a lot again sexual abuse because the rape of girls below 14 is very, very high, and then it's for them to know how to protect them, to know what is the abuse and how, okay, what are the rights. We have a lot of program in terms of sexual and reproductive rights in different countries. We have also about harassment in school. In France, it's more program education about, we have program also in school about human rights. One of our main concerns, for instance, in country like France, is that people, they consider that human rights and freedom, you know, I will say they almost no value them anymore. They were born with that. For them, you know, it's like the tree, the air. They don't realize how important they are. And we can see what with the anti-terrorist law we are adopted now in France, that people, they don't realize. And this to go back to the law and also about anti-discrimination. But really, it depends from one country to another. And unfortunately, for instance, in Bangladesh, no, we don't have any section. And I don't know if I answer to your question, but it really depends on the program we have. Then we can also have regional programs, and is how we empower people. For instance, we have in West Africa a program for human rights defenders. We also have a program in Strasbourg, in France, that is not led by Amnesty, but every year we invite different human rights defenders from different countries to join the program for 3 months in Strasbourg. You know, there are different programs, but it's really from one country to another regarding the reality of the country. Regarding Myanmar, Amnesty is it's very tough on this. And on Myanmar, we are very critical about what Aung San Suu Kyi is doing and saying, and we are very, very active on this, on the ethnic cleansing, and we are very active at the UN too. But it's quite difficult because, you know, in terms of geopolitics, I don't know how you say that, you know, you can see that there are areas, and Myanmar is really supported by China. Typically, and this is one of the failures of the international system, I say one of the failures, because in this particular case, such an another, we should, the Security Council should ask for the in the International Criminal Court, okay, to investigate on this situation and to ask for sanction. The only, the point is that Myanmar is not part of the Roma Treaty, the International Criminal Court, and to do so, it can be just the Security Council. Security Council, I don't know if you know the composition. You have US, UK, France, Russia, and China. It means that with China, we will never have, because they have the veto, and we will never have the International Criminal Court that who will take the case. Okay, this is the big question. It's a nightmare, but it's what's happening there. It's come also with yourself question. The big issue, you know, the big issue we have today is that corporation and state, they know that, you know, today is in the media. Nobody, everybody's aware. You know, during 2 days, 3 days, 2 weeks, you know, you are going to have the information on social network. You know, everybody will be really upset about the question, the issue. You know, it's going to be at high level. But you have an attack in France, and the topic is going to disappear completely from the screen. People are going to forget. You know, one of the worst examples for me, not because it's the worst case. I cannot qualify what is the worst case in the world we live. But, you know, in 2008, Obama, when he was elected, but in January 2009, exactly, when he was elected, the first decree he signed was to close Guantanamo. Okay? We are 8 years later. If you ask the people, most of the people on the world, there are sure, he closed Guantanamo. Guantanamo is not closed. There are still 100 people there, okay, of which many should be outside for 17 years, okay, and they are still there. But you ask the people, they are sure Guantanamo is closed. And every year when it's the anniversary of the opening of Guantanamo, I am with my, you know, close Guantanamo, people look at me and say, this lady was sleeping for the last 8 years, she doesn't know it closed. Okay, and no, but this is the point. And you know, if you take the case of Myanmar, it was on all the screen. Okay, and when, because it was at the UN General Assembly, but now, you know, day after day, they forget. And, you know, you know what is awful too, is that when you look at the concern of the politician today, it's they put I will say there are 3 points, at least in the West, you have to fight against terrorism, to control immigration, and the economy, you know? This is the 3 aspects. When you have a country that they say, oh, we are killing people, we are imprisoning people, but is to fight against terrorism, is to control migrants, and is to help you to develop because you are selling the arm to us, they say, okay, do your business as usual. This is the question, okay? And what is happening also in Myanmar is the fact that people were really upset with what's happened with the Rana Plaza, okay? But how many people do remember today, okay, which brand was buying there? That Walmart refuses to recognize. Other French brands, they refuse to recognize. people forgot. And then we as activists is to be here to remember that, you know. Every year we remember what's happening in Bhopal, okay, Guantanamo, okay, and we continue. The issue is to we have so much to remember to the people that we need you to join us.
Hello, good afternoon. Okay, my name is Julian, option B, I'm from Argentina.
Yes. Encantada.
So, three questions. The first one, first of all, thanks for being here. Thanks, Yelena and Felipe, for the seminar, I really enjoyed it. That's what my first question is, actually a point that they have already raised, is that how do you set your priorities according to all these conflicts you have? You have limited staff, 90 people here, so how do you choose where to focus? The second one is about your conclusion. You said that for cultural change, we need strong laws, heavy sanctions, and high fines. That's focusing on the stick aspect of the carrot and the stick. Do you think this is really enough in order to solve, let's say, prevention and also the reparatory actions for firms? And the third one, related to what you have just said, you said that the big three aspects that people are focusing today are terrorism, immigration, and economy. Have you worked in Amnesty International in the economic argument of why these disasters are bad from an pure economic perspective, or the strategies just to focus on the moral dimension, which is of course the most important one? Okay. Those are my three questions.
Okay. How we choose? This is, I will say, one of the most difficult part of what we do. And, you know, I think we have 7 million supporters and we have 7 million people thinking that their cause is the most important to handle, okay? And now what we do is every 4 years we define what we think they should the biggest campaign, at least. You know, we try to have global campaigns, okay, and then country by country we focus on different aspects we think is more urgent. For instance, right now, our two global campaigns, one is on refugees, because there is a very big crisis on this, and it's really a big crisis, and we try because we see that the refugee convention is really in danger today. Yesterday we issued a report on the how European Union is sending back to Afghani, when the UN report on last year and on this year shows that, and this is recognized by everyone, that, you know, since 4 years now, never the situation in Afghanistan has been more dangerous. Okay, just for last year, over 1,000 people were killed or severely injured. Okay, but between 2015 and 2016, you know, the number of Afghans sent back to their country was from 3,000 to over 9,000. Okay, and we know that they are going to death there. Okay, but information release was about the fact that, okay, if Afghanistan wants to receive, you know, the financial subvention for economy, they have to accept the people, and they have to accept something like 80,000 people to be sent back to Afghanistan. Then you see, for us, the refugee crisis today is not just that we are not able to accept to give them asylum, is that even the people who are in danger of death, they are sent back. And this is completely contrary to the convention. It's a very, very grave, and this is not done by Sudan or by Guatemala or, I don't know, you know, Saudi Arabia. It's done by the European Union, you know. Not only a territory who has who is giving the image of respecting human rights, but also have the financial resources to accept those people. Okay. That, then you see, this is a very one. And the second one is about human rights defender, but because we can see that, as I say, those are the people who are on the field to do the work, and they are very much at risk. If you look at the number of journalists, the number of activists, etc., that they are killed today, this is really very impressive. And then we have a worldwide campaign on that, because anyway, 2018 will be the 20th anniversary of the Declaration of Human Rights Defender, and we really want to reinforce and strengthen the protection of the people. But then, in France, we have, of course, we are working on refugee asylum, etc., but we are working also on the armed treaty, because we are selling arms to different people. We are working on Roma. We are working on the LGBT issue. We are working on the anti-terrorist law, because this is a priority for France today. You see, we have different. In other countries, it will be more about torture. And then also, we are, in fact, if you know, just myself, with my few team, we are four people. We are working on Mexico and US on the question of the indigenous women in Canada, mining in Guatemala and Honduras. We are working on Cuba, Venezuela, Colombia, Argentina, Chile. We do what we can. But and in fact, at the end, I don't know if we really choose. I think we really do whatever we can with the resources we have. Regarding the reparation, you say? Hein? Non, il y en avait une autre avant. The second one.
The second one was about your conclusion.
Ah, non, it's not my conclusion.
Oh, no.
Yeah, no, it's because I wrote this because it's from an official from South Korea.
Yeah.
No, for me it was very interesting because all the time, you know, what is opposed to us, that it's constraining, okay, corporation, it's against their competitiveness, etc., etc. But to have an official from South Korea, that it's perceived as a country very liberal, against any restriction, etc., in terms of corporation, business, human rights law, etc. To say that, it means that, okay, the question of hard law, soft law, okay, it depends, okay? And it depends what you want to protect and what you promote. Because if they say that, personally, I think it's not enough, okay? You need also education, you need many things. To change culture is not just about strong law. And we can see it in the case of rape or in the case of feminicide, okay? People can go, be sentenced 20 years, okay, of prison, but they continue to kill women, okay? Then, you know, it's not just that, but it was interesting in the, you know, in the confrontation of the idea of hard law, soft law when it comes to company, okay? And the third point about economic,
yes.
Yeah.
You want me to?
Yes, can you repeat, because?
So usually the first, or the ultimate line of defense, when you put this, let's say, we don't have money, that will hurt competitiveness, we cannot do that, we lost market share, blah, blah, blah. How to try to work against that argument, trying to prove internal files as that argument, I know, if we all do the same, that will hold, or arguments in that line. Or can you just focus on the moral dimension, which is that we are human, we can't do this?
Yeah. In fact, it's, of course, it depends on the case, okay? But, and it's, I think first it's not a matter of money.
No,
then, you know, it's, they say we don't have the money, okay? We are going to lose market, okay? But, and for this reason I say, the regulation for the data privacy protection, it's very interesting because this is European, okay? And they have a very, they are going to implement a very strong regulation, okay? And the first reaction for many of them is to say, wow, this is a lot of frustration, we are going to lose market, etc. 5-year negotiation that EU 11. But at the end, when you look at this, you see that, in fact, you are going to change completely the organization, the governance of the data, and this one is going to be, at the end, very much positive. And it's a very good point for the economy. But the first reaction is to say it's negative. And the second aspect is the risk. Okay, the risk for the shareholders, because we have the corporation, we have, you know, the people where the impact is going to be negative, but you have other people, is the shareholders. And the shareholders, they are investing money, and they want to keep their money. And they even want their money to grow, okay? But when it's a big issue, when it's a big problem, okay, they are making their money at risk. And one of the best stakeholders to lobby regarding, for instance, mining is when we have here in France the investor, you know, investor on specific company or corporation, they have mining projects, is to give them the information. Because we know that even if it's not going to be public, they are going to make pressure on the corporation, okay? And this is also something we have more and more to develop. It's developed in the US. It's about, you know, how you can influence the shareholder, etc. But this is a big point. Because, in fact, of course, as always, when you have a new regulation, you can, because it's not restriction. It's just to ask you to respect the right of the people. You know, Union Carbide, it has been a nightmare for them. They have been obliged to sell to Dow Chemical for almost nothing, okay? And to try to avoid the criminal court for the manager of the company, etc. You know, you can lose a lot of money when you have a scandal. And in fact, it's not, you know, I think they don't see enough how it's also to, even for the, if it's not for ethical, because they are not ethical, but just to manage risk, financial risk is very high. And the fact that we develop, for instance, class action, is very effective. Now we have this right in France. 5 years ago, we couldn't have the possibility of class action because, you know, when we say here, for instance, in the regulation for data privacy, it's up to 4% of the global turnover. But that you have to want, okay, this is defined, but then people, they go to the court if they have a very bad impact or negative impact on their life or on their, for themselves, they can have also very high fine. And you add. And this is how you anticipate that, how you manage the risk, and how also you improve the way you operate. And this aspect is not developed enough, okay? Because it just to greenwash, okay? They see it just like that, to hide, know how they can change their business to improve their business. And at the end of the day, okay, in some country, and at different level, this is something that can be developed. At the end of the day, you can say, if I operate clean, if I respect the people, okay, it can be an advantage, you know, a competitive advantage. It can be an advantage not only because I decrease the risk, not only because maybe it will be easier for me to operate, but also at the end of the day, I am also maybe going to recruit the best people to work in my company, the most creative, the most productive, okay? And this is something corporation has to understand. Has already understood that, and it's something they are developing, you know? And because, you know, to be a bad boy, okay, or bad guys, a bad company, you know. At the end, a lot of people, they don't like to work for this kind of company. And just a bit, bad guys go to work there, and it's not good for the business.
Hi, I'm Carmen from Option B. Thank you very much. I'm a big fan of Amnesty, and it was great to have you.
Good.
I have 3 points, so just one question of clarification. What was your exact definition of modern slavery? The second concerns again the Rana Plaza incident, because I think there's some interesting developments in the aftermath of Rana Plaza. So you mentioned the insufficient compensation, especially our colleagues here. What has also happened is that many auditing firms have been on the rise in order to improve working conditions there, because Western consumers obviously ask for higher standards. Many of these auditing firms also apply a Western catalog. That is, they apply Western standards. For example, firms need to provide a room for a cafeteria or a lunchroom, which then in many firms has replaced social value which has existed before. I unfortunately don't remember the name of the study, but in the study was shown that in a company where 97% of the employees were Muslims, the prayer room was replaced by a lunchroom, and nobody could really use this lunchroom because nobody had money to pay the lunch offered there. So I think the claim of Western consumers to expect the same quality at the same cost, which is actually what is happening, including bringing auditing firms into play that are Westernized and that profit the West in very general terms, is unacceptable and is obviously not a direction which is enough. Instead, concerted efforts that not only include the civil society but also the government, but especially unions and the labor force and the organization of the labor force are in this place, or not, I mean, we cannot replace this. This is the most important thing, I guess. And yeah, I wanted to know what's your specific take on unionization and labor in this field. And yeah, third, one question, whether Amnesty has yet reacted to the French and German cooperation in building a wall, basically, in lower North Africa in order to keep refugees away, thereby paying the Libyan border regime and also other shady dictators from Niger or Chad. Thank you.
Modern slavery is not my definition. It's the definition of the International Labour Organization. Okay, and I invite you to go to the site, etc. Because in fact, what I can see is that they are expanding now, as they are putting together the number of people that is on work, but also they include trafficking people, and please go there, and you know, it's because it's, in fact, the big difference, I will say, is that at some point when we talk about slavery in the past, people were belonging to someone from birth to death, and their descendants too, okay? Today, it's not exactly the same, but it's not the same, because you can be in a situation of slavery for 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, or for more. The typical case, it's about, you know, the domestic people, you know, yeah, people that are coming from, well, in different countries, they can come from Philippines, from Afghanistan, etc. They arrive from Morocco, and they arrive, they take out the passport, people, they cannot go out, they don't receive money, and they are almost in a jail. Okay, this is considered as a modern slavery. But you were talking about Libya. Okay, as you know, one of the problems in Libya is that the people coming from the sub-Saharan Africa. Most of them, when they are crossing Libya, they are attacked and they can stay in camp. They can be also sold to a group, to another group, to work as a, this is modern slavery because they include, and you have this with the trafficking, you know, because the people, you know, you can sell it, you can buy it, you have a slavery market in Libya, but people, you know, then they can be released, we don't know why. And for this reason, you know, this is different from the slavery as we had in the past. The question of, you know, of standard versus other standard, this is your question. Yeah, one thing we know, you know, is that human right is aspiration for all. Now, how you implement that? You cannot take the solution for you and to import somewhere else. I love one of the examples, you know, we need to work with people. This is important. Not only because they are not stupid, okay? They know what is good for them. They know what they need and how to do it, okay? But also because, you know, it's a way to empower them. And we don't have to think that we will be there for always, you know, forever, to tell them what they have to do, you know? The question is really to empower them. And one of the examples in terms of development I really like, it's the case, you know, it was in a village in Morocco. They didn't have the water on the at house. They have to go outside, okay, to with big jars every morning to take the water, morning and evening, okay? Then, you know, I don't know, Canada or another country say, okay, we are going to install the water in the kitchen for the women not to go anymore outside for the water. Okay, interestingly, women continue to go out. Why? Because it was the only place they could meet to chat with each other, and it was a social issue, okay? And why not? But, you know, why not to ask them? Is the water you want first? How do you want it? How you are going to manage that? This is a very simple case, but you know, very often, and this is one of the problems with the social responsibility, with saying, oh, we are going to open a hospital, we are going to open a school. But the problem is not the school, it's not the hospital, it's how the people are part of the project. And it's the same when you want to implement good ideas or when you want to have a new mining project. How you really, really, you involve the people, you work with them, and you find solutions with them. And this is all development program, all this program should be with this mind. And on my view, and I have been human resources director, you know, HR for me it's more human rights, but I have been human resources director for a company with factories, etc. And I am really convinced that union, it's really a need. Unionists in a company. In a corporation, you need people who has been elected by others or has been designed, who has a training. You know that they know, have education on works and on rights, or worker rights, etc. On the regulation, to talk with them, because for me it's exactly the same. You know, when we have to work because we increase a lot of production and we have to increase the shift, etc. For me, it wasn't only, you know, the manager of the department or the director of the factory to decide. It was to work with them to see how to put it in place, how, you know, to ensure that people felt part of it. Okay, I think really, and for me, unionist is very, very important, even after being human resources director. Okay, the sixth point is about Libyan. Well, Libyan, it's a terrific situation. It's really a nightmare situation. It's almost like Myanmar situation. Okay, it's a different reason, but the result, on my view, is the same. And here, exactly what we see, it's, you know, it was already the case between the Gaddafi, when Gaddafi was still the at the head of Libya, and Italy has a very nice agreement with him. We have been fighting against this agreement, and now it starts again. And, you know, it goes back to what I said to Afghanistan. It's the same with Sudan. Yeah, can you imagine Sudan? Sudan al-Bashir, the president of Sudan, has three persecution for war crime, crime against humanity, genocide from the International Criminal Court. But, okay, when it comes to send back, you know, migrant or asylum seeker from Sudan, we negotiate with them. We have even official from Sudan coming to Europe to give to take back those people. Okay, it's the same with Libya. It means that when it comes to control what they call the migrant flow. Okay, we are ready to negotiate with the devil, and it's what we are doing. And this is awful, awful because it's all the European value that we are really destroying. And if we destroy our value, what is kept? And it's very interesting because at the same time, you know, one of the reasons they gave us to not to accept those people, and not only to accept, to send it back to death. We had to say to use the right word on that, is that, you know, if we have all those people coming here, we are putting our culture, of value at risk. Those people, 1%, 2% migrants arriving to Europe, they are not going to put at risk our value. We are putting our value at risk. What we are demonstrating today is that we need nobody to put them at risk. We do it by ourselves. Après, il y a deux questions. Yeah, anyway, otherwise, at the end, we can go to the bar.
It's 4:45 already, so maybe we'll get a couple of questions.
And
we can answer more briefly than that. Then we'll have the last, the last two questions.
I'd like to go back to the issue of price purpose. Sorry. my name is Luisa, I'm from option A. Thank you for your presentation, it was very nice. I'd like to go back to the issue of privacy and the use of private data. I'd like to ask you please to explain a bit deeper which are the regulations that you said that are going to be implemented. I'd like to ask also for a deeper comment on the kind of risks that we are facing. And
when you say we as person?
We as society. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And if these regulations, the strong regulations that you mentioned, if they're also including the limit of storage of data, okay. And also a comment on what you said about the terms and conditions that we have the power of accepting the terms and conditions. What I read about it is that if we read all the terms and conditions that we accept, we would take like more than 200 hours per year, 250 hours per year reading terms and conditions. And actually the terms and conditions usually are not optional to us because we have to accept them. So it's kind of accept it or leave it terms.
Hi, I'm Benedict from Option B. So thank you again for coming. It was very interesting. I'm going to try to be brief, but essentially my question evolves around the issue whether or not, and if yes, in which case, in which form Amnesty International looks at these the modern type of trade agreements that are being negotiated all over the place. The most famous ones in Europe are probably CETA and TPP and TIPP and blah, blah, blah. Because what I think it shows very clearly is that corporations have a very clear understanding of how important a legal structure is that works, because they want their own private legal structure when it comes to protecting their investments. And so it shows the two-faced nature of corporations when they say, no, we don't need legal systems, but we need our own private legal system on the other hand. And I also think that there is a chance, and this is what my question is about, there's the chance of, if these treaties come, to also kind of try to negotiate protections of social and working conditions into these treaties when there already is a legal system being developed. And there is some civil society organizations that try to have an impact there, and I just was wondering if Amnesty does that. Thank you very much.
Très bon. Yes, on the privacy data, yeah. In fact, this is really high level protection for us, because even for profiling, they will have to tell us that they are going to use that for profiling. And what we say about the terms and conditions, this is completely going to change. And this is the good point. Because you can accept part of it or not, and it has to be clear, precise, and the type of information it will be defined. It's not term of condition of a contract. Okay, they are obliged to tell us what is the purpose, how, when, how long. They have to disclose everything, but in a clear, synthetic way, and we have to approve it. And at any time, we can stop our consent. But this is very important, because it will not be anymore optional for them. It's optional for us now. But this is from May 20th, 2018. But it's the regulation of is the new regulation of Europe has been adopted in 2016. And if you want, I sent anyway the link, and you have the translation in all European language, and you can find it. And if you want more information on this, I will send you more information. And even if you want, I can come and to explain to you, because it's really very, very important, because the rights we are going to have with this regulation, we never had in the past regarding privacy, and it's very important. And for the first time, it's recognized that European, you know, we have right to our privacy, and most important, they recognize that the data belongs to us and not to the corporation. Then we can modify as much, but we have the right on everything on the data. It changed completely the paradigm of the governance of data. Now, but we will talk on this because I'm 2 hours to develop, not too much. Regarding the problem on the treaty is not just about human rights impact. Okay, we try to develop this part of the analysis on the treaty. We cannot have a view on everything. It's too much. As you said, they have a lot of lawyers We have just a few resources. We are an NGO. Even if we are considered as the biggest one, we are just an NGO. The point is, we know, and there maybe I have a disagreement. If you don't start having a small piece of human rights in a treaty, it's very, very difficult to come back to that. And this is even more difficult because in the past, the European Union, one of the rules of the European Union is to have always a part on the respect of human rights and implementation, etc. And we see that the trend is more and more not to have anything on that. And if we accept that, the trend will be negative and not positive. Then no, we have to continue to fight on that. The aspect is for us to look at the impact on the human right of, we can see the clause, the specific part where it's claimed to respect human rights, but on the impact of the treaty on human rights, I think there are other organizations that they are really working on this, and at some time we have to make choice, and others are more expert than we to do that. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Maria Fernanda. I'm from Option C from Guatemala. And I have a question regarding what are the parameters for implicated on supporting certain causes, for example, in my country, because I saw that Amnesty International supported the closing of mining El Estor last year. But recently, Minera San Rafael closed operations, and I didn't saw anything that, or the poster of Amnesty International regarding that. Because for me, this mining did a lot of economic positive impact in the community. They gave like around $4 million per month to the municipality that was around, and they operated clean. But since I haven't seen any position regarding Minera San Rafael, I wanted to know, like, how do you evaluate which causes support or not in that area?
We take anyway. We cannot take all the cases, but in general, it's because we are working with other organizations based on the country. And we have, in the case of mining, we have also reported from other organizations. And then, because there are so many projects, we cannot analyze every project. And we took the cases that, for us, we have already documented grave abuses, etc. This is the point. Okay.
Hi, my name is Jinan. I'm from Bahrain, Option C. I have a long comment, but I will try to make it very brief. It's about the case you were mentioning, Syria, again and again and again. And it's an interesting case, but it's also a debatable case. Because when we are speaking about Syria, we are speaking about a government that is oppressive, authoritarian, Bashar al-Assad, versus opposition. But when we are speaking about opposition, which opposition we are speaking about? Are we speaking about Syrian opposition or opposition from all around the world, but not Syria? Because this is really an important issue. And it's always manipulated and used by the international community, by the media, to be against Bashar al-Assad. This is not to say that Bashar al-Assad has not done very criminal acts, but it was some of the cases was misused, manipulated by the ISIS, Daesh, or you can also call it the Syrian Free Army, for specific reason about this. So it's a lot of people, for example, in the Arab world, were raising accountability of these claims. Because you have a video, for example, anyone from the Arab world will know what I'm speaking about. The same child was used for many videos speaking about that he was, about attack used by Bashar al-Assad, but he was used again and again and again and again. Many pictures were in Egypt, were in Bahrain, was used.
Yeah, okay. I understood your question, and we can go to other cases. This is very interesting, your reaction, because I never spoke about the opponent of Bashar al-Assad. I never said that. Okay, I never said that. This is very interesting. And my only point I say about Syria is that we went there, okay, and you know, of course, you know, when is a conflict, it, for me it's a important question. You know, when the conflict started in Libya, you know, I remember very well because I was the spokesperson for Amnesty. You know, we start with 10 people dead, 20, 30, and we achieve 1,000. And journalists were asking for more and more. And sometimes you have the feeling that journalists are going to speak about a conflict because there is more dead people than the previous one. It's exactly what's happened with the deaths in the Mediterranean. You know, we achieved 500 in one weekend, and then everybody was talking about that. You have 450, nobody's talking. What's happened with Syria, it's that at the beginning, of course, and in some cases, maybe people were using picture, but, or maybe they were using video, but the fact that I am not going to discuss about the opposition, who is the opposition, who is the good opposition, who is Daesh, etc. The truth, the fact, and that is important, is the number of dead people, is the number of disappeared people, is the number of displaced people, is the number of people dead by torture. Okay, and those are facts. It's not a matter of opposition, it's not a matter of picture. You know, we know that over 80,000 people have disappeared in Syria. This is the truth. You know, we know that 10 of thousands of people has died because of the torture in the regime. We have found, and we had a report a few months ago about the prison and the, comment on dit les fosses, the mass grave, okay, found in Syria. This is true. We saw, and it's not about one video or two that they were misused, okay, it's about the picture, about the video. I went to Jordan. I met with the people, the refugees from Syria, okay? I met them, okay? And what I saw, what they told me, okay, is not about a picture that has been misused. You know, what's happened in the jail, what's happened there, it's awful, okay? It's a disaster, it's a crime against humanity. Then, what are the opponents? My point is not to judge who is the opponent. My point, and what I said from the beginning, are just the fact, what's happened to the people, and what's happened there, and what is continue to happen there. It's one of the worst crises happening today. Okay, and okay, what you can tell me whatever you want about the political issue, etc. I just see what the people are suffering, and I am very, very clear on that. Thank you. Okay.
Okay. It's 5 o'clock. Maybe the question was by trying to do some good, sometimes we get some bad.
No.
I mean, take the case of Libya. The French government
but
thought that it was good.
No, but you are taking the point. Here is not about to decide to have military intervention, etc. You know, it's just to say whatever happened in a country, whatever happened, nothing allows a government, okay, to arrest, to torture, to kill his people. This is the point. Now, intervention, military intervention, etc. We call for embargo, armed embargo. We call for humanitarian help, etc. But, you know, this is not our point. We are not going to make politics. We are not going to advise how they have to manage the conflict. What we say is that, you know, when people are arrested, when people are tortured, when they are killed, you know, nothing can allow that. This is a crime against humanity, this is a war crime. We cannot justify that school be bombed. We cannot justify market be bombed, hospital be bombed. We cannot justify civil to be a target. This is the point. Then, you know, if politicians take decisions that are wrong and they have bad impact, this is their issue. As a human rights organization, we look just about the impact on the life of the people. That's it.